following Four Aces production is for mature audiences only. Listener discretion is highly advised.
Yo, 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 what's up, y'all? What's up, what's up? Alpha?
Oh, shit. There you go. What's up, boy?
What's up? We are here to bring you this week's edition of the Cheap Pop Podcast. I know you guys have been missing us. I know we've been gone a couple of weeks now, but, you know, we're here to talk about some of the hottest topics that have been happening. And, man, I'm here. You know, I'm going to start this out like this. I'm going to start this out with a review of a series that kind of kicked off our entire podcast journey. Because I believe I reviewed Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. within the first five episodes that we did.
I'm pretty sure we started talking about that the very first episode.
Yeah.
Easily.
Yeah. So Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has been running for now seven seasons. They completed their seventh and final season, and they competed it in such an epic way. But it's all right, so basically, for those of you who watched Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. from episode one, like I have, you noticed that midway about through season three or so, season four, the show kind of started to detach from the movies. Like, I believe through Captain America Winter Soldier, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. kept up with the movies, because the whole Hydra takeover and downfall was all included in Captain America, as well as that particular season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Well, they kind of did a thing, kind of like, I'll say it like this: they didn't copy off of Arrow for Arrow's final season. You know, I think I've explained to you, like, Arrow's final season kind of plays as, like, an homage to every season of Arrow leading up to season 8. Like each individual episode, like episode 1 harkens back to season 1, episode 2, season 2, etc. Right? Because, yeah, there were only, I believe, 8 episodes in the 8th season. Or 8 or 10 episodes, because then there was the Crisis episode, and then there was the Aftermath. But they did kind of an homage in this one, like where basically the Zephyr is a time machine now. But here's the funny thing about it: the Zephyr is making random jumps, because at the end of the season six, at the end of season six, they kind of discover this thing that allows them to jump to places. But they figured out how to make you jump through time. And it's connected to the Zephyr's main thing, and, like, literally randomly, like, it'll jump them to, like, 1985. And they'll be there for, like, 48 hours, and then they got to figure out kind of why they're there and what they need to go after and these things that they're supposed to be doing, right?
Well,
they get to the... And I'm talking about, they took every major storyline in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and wrapped it up in a nice little bow. And also established the fact that the last, like, couple of seasons of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. since about Infinity War, okay, was the last time there was even a reference to the movies made on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Okay, because the final season of Agents, or that season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Kind of coincides with, I believe it was season 5, kind of coincides with Thanos' attack on New York from Infinity War. Okay.
So it fits on the timeline.
Right. And so that's kind of like the last. So basically what ends up happening is that, and I kind of thought this too, because I believe I mentioned it when we talked about these seasons before. I think they went with the spacey thing, and I believe it was season 6. and the rant, you know, they had, where like half the season was about them being in space and getting back to Earth and realizing they had jumped forward in time and then getting back in time, and then the second half of the season was about that rod with the demons that burrowed into the people's body and the aliens and all that shit. Like season six is weird. Like, if you really watch it, it's two completely separate seasons, but it's weird. But it's the last time that they season six has them jump forward in time. But here's the thing about it: you remember, there's no mention of the snap. Like, at no point in season six or season seven do they ever acknowledge the snap. And basically, they kind of explain that away with, oh, spoiler alert for those of you who have not seen the series finale. They basically explain it away using a vehicle or a written vehicle from Ant-Man and the Wasp. They use the quantum realm. But they've somehow figured out how to use the quantum realm to jump in between timelines.
Okay.
It's like a very interesting way of doing things. I'll let you guys kind of watch and see how they put it all together. But it's a very interesting concept. And it actually harkens back to, I don't know if you guys remember, a couple of episodes ago, I was talking about they had this random episode with Daisy where she just kept waking up in this cycle and living the same day over and over again.
Groundhog Day style.
Right. And so, like, but at the end of it all, they flash forward a year and they show you where everybody's at. And so, once again, spoiler alert, for those of you who haven't seen it, basically Big Mac, basically turns out to be the new Nick Fury. Like, when they show where he's at, like, he's on the top of a shield helicarrier giving orders. And he's got the big black jacket like Nick Fury. All right?
Fucking nice.
My, the Calvary, which, by the way, I do have to give this much away. There was a moment that you truly have to have watched all of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. to get. There's a moment where they're sitting there and Coulson, well, the LMD version of Coulson, is standing before the leader of the Chronicons, and they're talking, and he's like, now's where I get the smile. And she's like, why? And he's like, because of this, right? And May drops in, right? And she looks up at her and she goes, because the Calvary is here. And then she starts kicking ass, right? I caught it because I was like, that is so dope. You get like the last 5 minutes of the final episode of the series, and May finally calls herself the Calvary. Like, throughout the entire series, from episode one on, she kept telling people, don't call me that. Don't call me that. There's even jokes to it when they're talking to each other, and Fitz and Simmons are like, nah, don't call her that. She don't like being called that. And at the end, you have this moment where she drops in and refers to herself as the Calvary. And it was
fucking
just one
full show in the making.
Exactly. I was like, it's just one of those type of things, which, by the way, I have a rant to go off on regarding the Randy Orton Drew McIntyre match at SummerSlam, and it's not what you think. But I have a rant to go off on when we get to the second half of the show.
Ooh, keep that ready then. Keep that warm.
Yes. So Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. just ended in every way possible. But Mai is now a professor at the new Coulson Academy, where they train the new S.H.I.E.L.D. agents. Coulson's LMD is still traveling the world, trying to discover itself, I guess. Sousa from Agent Carter and Daisy are now dating and flying around as ambassadors to Earth with Daisy's sister from another timeline.
That's Jesus.
Yeah, that
okay,
one.
So you have your Philip Coulson fucking clone just roaming around, finding himself in a reality that isn't his.
And then who else was it? And then Fitz and Gemma have had a child, and are raising it off retired somewhere. And I was just like, okay, these are nice little fitting endings for everybody. But everybody's still. Oh, and Yo-Yo is working out in the field, capturing 084s for S.H.I.E.L.D. And I guess they brought, he died in, I think it, when they were trapped in the lighthouse. Dude died. I can't remember what agent he was, but he was linked in with the female agent. And they built him, but he died at the hands of the broad with the little demon things that came out of the, I can't remember her name. She was in the second half of last season. But she, yeah, she killed him. She like took over him and killed him. But they brought him back as an LMD. Like for the final episode.
Of course.
Yeah, so Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. ended in a very, very good way. I can't wait for the seventh season to hit Netflix, because I will be binge watching the series again from beginning to end. Or at least when I got the time. Man. Let's see. All right. Yeah. So, all right. So next up was Stargirl, who had their season finale. Very well done. It was a two-parter. Luke Wilson wrote, they introduced Solomon Grundy, and it's actually one of the best versions of Solomon Grundy I've ever seen.
Portrayed on a DC show.
Instead of just looking like, okay, like in Gotham, like that one dude that was Penguin's bodyguard eventually became Solomon Grundy.
Right.
But they just kind of made him this big, like, goofy dude, like Forrest Gump-looking dude. You know what I'm saying? This was like a CG-animated, like, Solomon Grundy. Like, dude looked like this big old monster. And, it was crazy because they had him get into a fight with Stripe, who was Luke Wilson, and this gigantic robot. And Stripe's, for the most part, whipping his ass, right? But Grundy eventually gets the best of him because Grundy starts to realize, wait a minute, this is a robot. So he rips off one arm. And then he rips off a leg. And he rips off the other leg. He rips open the chest. You know, and as he's going to kill Pat, who is Luke Wilson's character, Our Man comes in and knocks him off and looks at him. He's like, then now it's my turn. And he starts going to work on Grundy. Just pow, pow. So basically, for those of you who don't know what Our Man's power is he has this hourglass, all right? And when it's done draining, he can flip it over, and for 1 hour a day, he can flip it over, and he gets unlimited strength for an hour. Right? So there's this scene where they come back to him whipping Solomon Grundy's ass, right? And he's like, I got him. And he shows him, they show him, throw Solomon Grundy to the side of the room. And he starts walking towards him. He goes, I got 5 minutes left, and they all for you. And I was just like, damn. Okay, so to give you a little background, Solomon Grundy is the one who killed Our Man's parents, the new Our Man's parents, when he was young.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because the new Our Man, his father was the original Our Man.
I like that twist.
Yeah. So what was it? One of the other major twists was Shiv, Dragon King's daughter, is actually the one who ended up killing him. Like she killed Dragon King because he kept her locked up. And somebody finally let her out, and so first thing she did was shank her dad.
Well, goddamn it.
Yeah, but the fight scenes were pretty friggin' awesome, dude. The way that they did them, with all the kids and everything, and everybody kind of had their moments where they did the one thing, because like there's a dude called the Gentleman, and he's a hacker, And so, like they had this moment where Beth, the little shy girl, was like, you know, in a hacking contest with him, and they're trying to hack into they're using this like super advanced computer to try to hack into the thing, but the dude's blocking it. And he's like, every time I break down a firewall, he's throwing up another one. He's like, you know, it's an endless battle. And then the guy goes, but wait a minute. But I'll tell you something he can't do. And she's like, ah. And she starts seeing things come out. And he's like, he can't protect his bank accounts. And so they go after all of his bank accounts and just start donating all of his money to various charities. So there's this scene of her just sitting there hitting donation accepted, donation accepted, donation. And you just see the money draining out of his accounts. He's pissed. He's like, damn it. But like, yeah, like I said, yeah, everybody had their moments. Like, and that's what made it great. And then they ended it showing that there are still more villains out there. Like, Shiv escaped and she found this powerful crystal. So she's obviously going to be a part of season two. And then there was this other guy named Smoke, I believe his name was, that was still there. So he's probably going to come up in season two. And then the big reveal at the end of it all is... I think his name is Sam Pemberton himself, shows up at Pat's, which is Luke Wilson's character, Stripe. He shows up at his old apartment and looking for him. Well, for those of you who don't know who Sam Pemberton is, Sam Pemberton is Starman, believed to have been dead since the beginning of the season. So,
okay.
Season 2 looks like it's going to get interesting. They haven't given a release date. So far, they just said sometime in 2021. At this point, they're thinking what as good as it did in the ratings, that it's a show that most likely will get a primetime slot in the middle of the fall lineup.
I like that. I had a lot of fear of this show. Ending up going the same route that Titans did, where I ended up without a platform, or even then, like, in terms of how it's perceived,
yeah.
Titans really isn't perceived as the most important out of all these DC, out of the DC, like, fucking pantheon of shows, right? And so I feared Stargirl getting that same curse, because stylistically it is a lot different than the other ones, much like Titans is. So I'm glad that it's flourished the way that it has, because I find it quite fucking enjoyable.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Like the storyline gets a little wonky in some of the middle episodes. Say, like, yeah. Episode 7, 8 or so. Storyline gets a little wonky, but overall it recovers for the finale. And yeah. Solid finish. Can't wait for season 2. All right.
Shit.
So let's see, where are we at now? All right, yeah. So we're about in the middle of this segment, so let's go with this. Found this question on Comics Call to Action on Facebook, and thought I'd share it with our listeners who can comment down in the chat room with their answers and get a good answer from Mr. Alpha there and myself. But what was the bigger comics moment? Wolverine slicing his way out of the Hulk, or Magneto removing all of Wolverine's adamantium? Alpha, I'll let you take the lead on this one.
Okay, sweet. I'm more than happy to go first. So, for me, Wolverine slicing his way out of the Hulk is only just a bit lower in how important it was, only because I feel like I've seen that done a handful of times now. I'm not going to say that it was done too many, but I've seen it in multiple iterations. You know, they always harken back to the Wolverine versus Hulk fight,
right?
Because, you know, whether everyone knows it or not, Wolverine debuted against the Hulk. He was a Hulk villain from the very beginning, if you remember, right?
Okay.
And so we've seen that in, like, we saw that, what, in the 90s, right? And then we saw that happen again in the Old Man Logan storyline, too. He did the same thing to Maestro, which is the older version of Hulk.
Right.
But for me, only because there is only one image and one time where Magneto, like, viciously just drained every bit of the adamantium from his skeleton as savagely as he did, I feel like that's just a little bit more important to me.
Okay.
Like, I don't know about you, but when I hear that moment, I think about the still image in my head. Like, you can think about the 90s style that was with it.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's just...
I believe that was Jim Lee drawing him at the time.
Yeah, exactly. That was Jim Lee's, which is arguably one of the best, right? And, like, I don't know about you, but that image of Wolverine stretched out in the sky and all of it just being pulled from his skeleton is something that, as a comics fan, I have never, ever forgotten. So for me, that's just a little bit higher.
Okay,
so you go ahead.
We are 100% in agreeance, and for similar reasons. Here's the deal with me. That moment was the Wolverine slicing his way out of Hulk, classic. You know what I'm saying? But the Magneto Wolverine moment was the first reality moment for me in reading comic books. And what I mean by reality moment is this. Real life, you have this dude who can control any metal on the planet. And he's developed his skills to the point where he literally can control any metal on the planet. Okay? And he comes across
Never forget, Magneto can change the axis of the Earth with magnetism. Never forget that.
Right. So you have this dude, this powerful dude when it comes to magnets. And then you have this dude whose basically entire inner structure is made of metal. Okay, in my personal opinion, this would be the last dude I would want on the front lines against a dude that can control metal. And the reason being exactly what happens in that particular comic book. Not to say it was an easy feat for Magneto. But I've always imagined, like the original X-Men movie kind of brought to life what I figured a battle between Wolverine and Magneto would be like. When Hugh Jackman jumps at him and Ian McKellen just kind of goes, yeah, dude, no. Like just no.
Yeah.
Like, why'd you even try? Like, and so, like, that's what I've always envisioned. You know, like, I could see if somebody, like, if you're fighting as a team against Magneto and somebody else has him distracted, yes, Wolverine could be vicious and deadly against Magneto. But just one-on-one, Magneto sees him coming. Come on, dude. Your body's made out of metal. Like, come on, dude. Your best option is to turn and run. I hate to say it because I know Wolverine is that type. That Wolverine, like, dude, to me, Wolverine was like Lobo. Like, this is why I always like that whole thought process of the crossover between Wolverine and Lobo. It's like both of them were just like, fuck it, there's a fight, I want in. You know, like
yeah, exactly.
But you gotta be smart sometimes. And facing a dude that can control metal when your entire skeleton is kind of covered in it, not exactly the brightest ideal on the block.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm a Wolverine fan.
Like, as a kid. Exactly. Like, I'm saying this as somebody who adores Wolverine. Like, I always grew up thinking, like, all right, what's Magneto's gimmick?
Yep.
Any metal is kind of sort of his bitch by design, right? Yep. And so one of his adversaries fucking is a dude made completely head to toe in metal from the inside out. I had always thought about it, like, well, why doesn't Magneto just crumple the fucker up like a piece of paper?
Yep.
Like, he can.
It's like this.
So it was like, why is there a fight between there?
It would be like this. Tony fucking Stark is not getting within like 75 yards of Magneto. Like, Tony's going to be like, dude, nah. Like, I'm basically encased in a metal shell. Nah, I'm good. Like, y'all go in there, Thor. Y'all go in there, handle your business against him. But I'm going to float back here for a second, kind of out of his range. And then maybe I'll shoot some long distance shots out my chest, you know, hit him with a couple of things to distract him. But like, but I'm good on getting right up on him. Cause you know, at that point I'm pretty much, well, you know, like roast in a pan, so to speak. So, you know, dude, just going, and I'm going to be gone. I'm good, you know. Genius, man. I think about this shit, you know.
You're right.
But on the real though, yeah, nah, it was just a bigger moment for me because, like I said, it brought that aha reality. It's like, okay, somebody thought about this and said, okay, what would happen? Okay, yeah, this is what would happen. He's freaking Magneto, dude. Like, just no.
Exactly. Yeah, man, I love that.
Like
shit.
Static Shock going after Aquaman. Image. That just don't make sense. or should I say Aquaman going after Static Shock? Like Static be like, really, really Aquaman? Bzzz. Like fried fish? What are you talking about?
Dirty.
I am. All right, man. So speaking of comics, as y'all know, recently I've gotten into my Marvel Unlimited subscription, which I completely recommend. And I've been reading The Age of Apocalypse, the 1995 release of it from Marvel. The Age of Apocalypse kind of spanned about 5 or 6 comic books that went about 3 or 4 issues each. There was Generation Next, which I just got done reading, which basically the entire four issues of the comic book is about Colossus, Mr. Rasputin, going and saving Ileana, because at a certain point in the Astonishing X-Men, Magneto's Astonishing X-Men, they figured out that Ileana, Rasputin's sister, Colossus's sister, is the key to saving the world. Bishop has told Magneto this. So they went and found her. Yeah. And so they went and found her, and like the whole series of it. But bro, they literally like damn near kill off like half the damn people that they introduce you to before the issues are done.
Yeah, like, man, Age of Apocalypse and Age of Ultron are noticeably pretty fucking dark.
Yeah, and so like, yeah, like, dude, at one point, like, Rasputin's like, because it's Kitty Pryde, he calls her Katya, but in this particular version of whatchamacallit, of the X-Men universe, Kitty Pryde married Rasputin. Well, they didn't officially get married, but they basically consider each other husband and wife. And so, like, she's the one that helps him break into this core place and to try to break out his sister. But, like, yeah, it's a great comic book, great read. As I said, for $9.99 a month. I've just started Gambit in the Externals, issue 1. So I'm going to be moving on to 2.
Gambit in the Externals.
That it was a really good series. It's another mission that Gambit was sent on by Magneto during the Astonishing X-Men series. It's another side.
Ooh,
mission.
Okay.
Yeah. So like I said, there was about
is it a team piece or is it
yeah
just
it's a team piece?
Gambit?
No, it's Gambit leading Jubilee, and then there's a couple of new X-Men that they introduce that become the Externals. I haven't gotten past page 1, 2, and the last time I actually read the comic book, which I own, was almost 2 decades ago, so I don't quite remember everything that happened.
Older than Alpha.
You know, but Apocalypse, man, I'm telling you, like, this Age of Apocalypse, like, the world that they give you now that Apocalypse has taken over is just so vivid. And so just, like, human beings are basically nothing but, like, Energon cubes, to use a Transformers reference. And those mutants who oppose Apocalypse are killed, and those who wish to serve him will get to live. And it's just this dark world, and Magneto's the leader of the X-Men because Charles Xavier's own son came back and killed him. And I haven't even gotten to a series that spawned from the Age of Apocalypse series, but continued on after the Age of Apocalypse series, the final issue in Omega came out, and it was the series called X-Man. And I believe I've talked about him on the show before, but he's the son of Scott Summers and Jean Grey.
Ah, yes, the Omega level mutant. Right.
Yeah. So he has the psionic powers out the one eye, but he also has telekinetic or telepathic powers as well. Like, yeah.
Right.
That was one of my favorite series. I can't wait to get to that one. I'm almost saving it for last. Man, I'm
Sorry, go ahead. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, like, it's just a great series to read. I'm glad I'm starting out there, but it's not going to be the final series I read. Like I said, there's over 30,000 comic books on that Marvel universe, and I may not read them all, but I'm going to get quite a few in.
Some good shit. You should read Civil War. The OG Civil War story is easily one of the best.
I'm thinking so.
Read that.
Like
that'd be a good choice.
That may be what's coming up next. So,
that'd be a good choice. I think that was like one of the biggest disappointments. Like aside of that, I'm saying one of the biggest disappointments I had with the Age of Ultron, the Age of Apocalypse movie. Like I really loved it. Don't get me wrong. I like the cast, and I really fucking love Oscar Isaacs as Apocalypse. I've always adored that.
They did not portray him.
Yeah, exactly. In the Age of Apocalypse stories, I feel like they do a really good job of painting the type of world that they live in there. They do a good job of showing you how miserable everyone is living like that, and how fucked up and in tatters, and how it all is in ruins purely because Apocalypse won.
Yeah.
And with the Age of Apocalypse movie, I feel like they didn't really paint as good of a picture of the world they live in. Logan did a good job of doing that, but Age of Apocalypse didn't really hit it home to me that everything was fucked and this is the world that they would live in if Apocalypse managed to win.
And like you say, the comics themselves convey that beautifully. But like you said, I think they missed the mark trying to be too fancy. Like, I think they got Apocalypse all wrong. Like, where's Mr. Sinister? Like, Mr. Sinister was his right-hand man through most of the Apocalypse. Where's Mr. Sinister? Like, you get no Mr. Sinister. You get no Havoc. You know, like, where are these key and critical characters to the Apocalypse storyline? You know, and to me, it felt like the Apocalypse movie that was done felt like it was rushed, and also like it treated Apocalypse like a throwaway character. And I'm like, whoa. No, Apocalypse like is by far one of the biggest villains that the X-Men ever face. Ever. And you just kind of minimized him.
Like, the idea is that like Havoc, Apocalypse, Thanos, and Darkseid are all on this same level of being a threat, you know?
Exactly. And I'm glad you brought up Thanos, because I was going to say that. Imagine if they tried telling all of the Thanos story in one movie. Imagine if all of the whole storyline with Thanos came to a conclusion and was done all in Infinity War. You'd be like, okay, it's kind of anticlimactic. Like, the fact that Infinity War was like this beginning point to what the overall universe ended up to be, and the Endgame wrapped it up beautifully, created this story that could have been told. And the Apocalypse story could have and should have been told over multiple movies. To try to start it and end it all in one movie, you have to have the moment where Apocalypse either comes close to victory or wins. And then the X-Men have to bounce back. You have to have that moment.
Get me started on how downplayed the Four Horsemen were in the movie by comparison to the comics.
Yeah. 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 And I'm talking about like...
Mm-hmm.
We've only been introduced to, I think... No, we've been introduced to all four Horsemen. We were introduced to them in an Astonishing X-Men. And, yeah. Like, these are singular badasses. And as a team, damn near unstoppable.
And that's like supposed to be the idea, exactly.
And right Mr. There. Sinister was at the head of that. And if you don't have Mr. Sinister, you're just not telling the Apocalypse story correctly. Period.
Exactly.
Oh, that's the other thing, too. Is in Age of Apocalypse, Scott Summers and I forgot the brother's name. I forgot Havoc's name.
Isn't that Gabriel Summers?
Yeah. So Scott and Gabriel Summers are the sons of Mr. Sinister.
Right, I forgot. That's a twist, huh?
Yeah, so they work at the right hand of Apocalypse. I was just like, see, like, they missed so many things like that in the way that they did that movie. Like I said, that should have been a series of movies. That should not have been just a singular movie.
I agree with that. You know, there should have been a lot more build-up time in that. You're right. Half the reason that Thanos became the instant pop culture icon that he was because he had how many movies to build up?
Mm-hmm.
Not even like, and I mean from the very beginning. I mean every little small scene included. That's like what four movies of build up before he even became a key player in the movie, right?
Exactly. Before we get to Infinity War, and even if you're going through Infinity War, it takes almost half the movie before Thanos becomes a consistent part of the storyline because you're fitting all the other pieces together.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So, you know, just great storytelling in the comics, great storytelling in the whatchamacallit. I would love to see Marvel Studios, not Sony, not the people who used to own X-Men. I would love to see Marvel Studios take on the Age of Apocalypse. Because I wonder if they would go with the 1995 series and do it like that.
I think they would do it right. I can see that. Because they've proven, I think, that they can do the slow game with it.
Yeah.
Even with how like fast-paced the presentation might have been in comparison to other things, I think if they can do anything akin to that again with the X-Men, easy money.
Easy money. They can make billions on each movie. Speaking of trying to make a lot of money off of a movie, we both know that the Avengers game is coming out soon.
Yes, sir. I have gotten myself that motherfucking beta.
Yeah.
And that shit is good.
Now, of course, the both of us owning a PS4, this does not really affect us much. But you poor, poor, poor PC users, or not PC users, but Xbox users, the people that only play on the Xbox. Because according to comicbook.com, the Avengers game will feature Spider-Man, but only on the PS4. Now, Saint claims that this is not Sony's call and that Sony has nothing to do with it. I'm not buying it. I'm just not buying it. Like, you can't tell me that, or no, sorry, not on a PS4, on a PS5. It's only going to be on the PS5 version. You can't tell me that it's not a ploy to try to make sure that they outsell Xbox. Because at this point in time, when you look at the specs, it truly looks like the Xbox One Series is the better system, hardware-wise.
Oh, you think so? We'll have to talk about that.
Yeah, well,
I think that's later, though. Go ahead.
Yeah. But you know, so Sony's got to have a way to bring people. You know, of course, the diehards are going to. There's far more PS4 diehards than there are Xbox diehards, so they were going to outsell them there anyway. But after the diehards, the casuals, it's something that's likely to bring them to the PS5 as opposed to the Xbox One or Xbox Series One. But yeah, so your thoughts on Spider-Man only being available on the PlayStation version of Avengers?
Well, for one, of course, it's a fucking marketing ploy. Of course, it's to get those exclusive points, you know. Everybody knows one thing about, like, regardless of whatever your opinion is on the console wars, you have to say one thing, and it's that Sony puts in the fucking effort to have exclusive rights to a lot of different shit.
Yes,
God
sir.
Of War, Spider-Man. The moment Dark Souls 3 hit big, the very moment that Dark Souls 3 started to sell big, you know what Sony did? They came up to Frontsoft, and they're like, hey, we'll license your game, we'll pay for the whole fucking thing, but guess what? It's going to be a PS4 launch title exclusive. And that's why Bloodborne can't be found on any other console except a PS4. If it's anything that Sony is very, very serious about, it is having those exclusive rights to shit just like that. Like, do you think it's any coincidence that it is Spider-Man? Like,
yeah.
must we sit down and remind ourselves that Spider-Man is probably the flagship superhero, not just for Marvel, but the flagship superhero.
Yep.
Like, is it any coincidence that they nabbed up Spider-Man specifically as the exclusive for that game for them to specifically?
I don't think
so. No, sorry, Bob. am I angry about it? No. But is it a surprise? Absolutely fucking not. Go ahead.
Well, no, I was going to say, that can actually slide us in. You mentioned Bloodborne, so that can slide us into Alpha's Edition. And you can go on and drop your review there, sir.
Oh, wait. Do you want to say your opinion on it first?
On Bloodborne?
Oh, no. On Spider-Man being
a Sony being a PS4? Well, I kind of gave my opinion. I think it's a marketing ploy, like, by Sony, because you can't tell me. Sony owns the rights to Spider-Man when it comes to this particular medium. You know what I'm saying? Like they've given up the rights on the movie screen, or they're sharing the rights on the movie screen with Marvel. You know, which brings Marvel in on the Venom series and the Spider-Man versus Venom series, which is awesome, and the potential multiverse live action movie that we talked about before. But I think that it's a ploy. Like I said, I was gonna be somebody that over time I'll probably buy my Xbox One series first. Those that I normally get my Xbox closest to release. And then eventually, sometime by mid-next year, I'll own a PS5, too. So, yeah, I might miss out on a couple months of being able to play the games right when they come out, but I'm good with that. You know, but I just don't see any reason not to buy them both.
That's very true. My golden rule is never buy a new console first year of release. Why? Because second year, they're going to release the better version.
Yep. Not to mention the fact that people don't understand this particular concept about video games, is normally when a new system comes out is right about when developers start really being able to figure out what the old system's engine can do. Mm-hmm. Like, that's why if you ever talk to developers, they'll tell you, like, dude, this shit's fucked. Every time we get used to a system, here comes a new one. Every time we finally get to the point where we can start providing, you know, friggin' A quality games with the engine that they're giving us. You know, you know, as soon as we get to the point where we can start providing that, then all of a sudden they switch everything up on us. Next thing we know, then we got to do something new. And so that's another reason to wait at least a year in after an initial console comes out, because after a year in, then by that point, developers have really started, and you're starting to get these quality games. A year, year and a half in, then that's when you're really getting your top quality games. So, I think it's a ploy to try to get more people to buy PS5, more to casuals. Because we all know in every market, just like with wrestling, when you're looking at fans, in gaming as well, when you look at fans, your goal is to catch the casual fan. The places that are going to make a lot of money are the places that catch the casual fans.
Mm-hmm.
So,
what catches the casual fan more than Spider-Man?
Exactly. Everybody knows Spidey. That's a face and a name everybody knows, whether you play video games or not. That's a name you know. Whether you like comic books or not, you know who Spider-Man is.
Yeah, exactly. And that's not even to sit here and say, like, Sony's fucking rubbing their hands together like a greedy corporation. It's like, no, that's smart, and I would do it too.
Yep, that's business. That's business. Point blank and simple. All right, so yeah, you want to go into your review of Bloodborne, and then we'll close out with the Howard the Duck review and some talk about Catwoman.
Yes, I can do that. All right, last week I came here and I brought a little retrospective on my little view on the Soul series. And so I'm going to be comparing and going back and forth, because obviously Bloodborne is much, much like the Souls series, with just a few minor tweaks and a big twist on the aesthetics. So it is very, a lot like those. If you like Dark Souls, then you're probably going to like Bloodborne. It's the same model, different coat of paint. But there are a lot of gameplay tweaks that are unbelievably fun to fuck with. First and foremost, I am a massive, massive, massive fan of the works of H.P. Lovecraft and the Lovecraftian universe of writing.
Okay.
Regardless about him as a human being, his works and his shit is everything I'm all about.
It's like the Harry Potter woman.
Wait, what?
It's like the Harry Potter woman. Like, even though the shit she been saying recently, J.K. Rowling is all fucked up.
Oh yeah.
You know, like, that don't mean Harry Potter is any worse of a story. Like, it's still a good story. It's still great characters, but it's just a fucked up mind that came up with it. But go on.
Exactly. I said it a while back. What is it again? Separate art from the artist.
Yep.
But Bloodborne, whereas Souls has this sort of dreary, I wouldn't say gothic, but dark medieval tone to it. Bloodborne is 100% eldritch, gothic, Lovecraftian, absolute nice. Mess. And it is fucking great. Dark Souls employs a more passive sort of combat approach, which, you know, like, how do you approach combat passively? I know, right? But you have to pick your moments and combat runs on a metronome. You have to pick your shots wisely, and you use different items to pick your moments and create windows. Bloodborne is like Souls, but in fifth fucking gear on a V8. The whole game plays at a million miles per hour. To be good at the game, you have to be very high intense pressure, and that change in style is fun as shit when you learn how to use it. The combat in the game is so fast and smooth that when you come down to what's called the hunter duels, where it's you versus another character of the same class and size, the hunter duels, it basically come to being so fucking fast that it feels like you're dancing. It feels like you're watching. Yeah, it feels like you're like watching a badass.
Like Devil May Cry.
Exactly, a lot like Devil May Cry. Yeah. A lot of back and forths, and it's the same way with the bosses. The bosses this time come in around two flavors, whereas in Dark Souls you have a lot of different types of enemies. Bloodborne is restricted to basically two types of enemies: hunters and beasts. Beasts are usually 7 foot tall giant monsters that you're fighting. Hunters are more your size.
Yeah.
And so approaching them differently is key. And the game, much like Souls, is changed with the advent of multiplayer. You can invade other people's worlds just to piss on them. Or you can invite a friend and play as a team through the whole game. Which I actually just played the entirety of Dark Souls 3 with my girlfriend the whole way through, and we're doing it again on New Game Plus. It's a fucking blast. But that's aside the point, this is on the multiplayer. But Bloodborne, the bosses in it are much, much harder than that of what I've experienced before. Playthrough 1 of Bloodborne was a little bit harder than New Game Plus 4 of Dark Souls 3.
Okay.
I mean that shit. Bloodborne is fucking hard. It's completely worth it, though. It is 100% rewarding. The bosses are fun to play through, save for like one or two, and by God, the fucking soundtrack is great. Much like in Souls, they do this thing where the soundtrack isn't really too remarkable, save for two or three areas, but all of the bosses have their own themes.
Yeah.
And so, to give you like my top three favorites from Bloodborne, to go and check them out, the Cleric Beast theme is an absolute fucking banger. Lady Maria of the Astral Clock Tower is a fucking banger. And the theme for Ludwig the Holy Blade is hands down the best.
Yeah.
The fights with Ludwig and the fights with the Orphan of Kos are teeth grindingly difficult, but so goddamn fun.
Yeah.
Bloodborne is probably the most visually appealing out of all of the Souls series. And if I were to rank it anywhere, it would be definitely above Dark Souls 2, but not above Dark Souls 1. So it is hands down an A-plus game, worth every bit of $60. It was on deal a little bit ago, and if it's on deal again, then I recommend anyone buy it. Much like any Souls game, the DLC is hands down the best part. And it's best taken slow. So my retrospective of Bloodborne, amazing. And once again, fuck Dark Souls 2.
All right. So while you were enhancing our minds with that, I decided to do a little little digging on a film that I watched recently by the name of Howard the Duck. For those of you who don't know about Howard the Duck, it's a 1986 film, a science fiction comedy, filmed and directed by William Hyuk, and starring Leah Thompson, Jeffrey Jones, and the one and only Tim Robbins. It is based on a Marvel comic book by the same name, which was produced by Gloria Katz and written by Hyuk and Katz, with George Lucas as the executive producer. That one I didn't know until I watched it. The screenplay was originally intended to be an animated film, but the film adaptation became live action because of a contractual obligation. Although several TV adaptations of characters had aired during the preceding 21 years, this was the first theatrically released feature film, coming after the serial Captain America, which I looked into was a movie that was created in the 1940s involving the character Captain America. So that's one of your first ever, like, comic book
Marvel movies.
Yeah, Marvel movies, yep. Lucas proposed adapting the comic book following the production of American Graffiti. After multiple production difficulties and mixed response to test screening, Howard the Duck was released on August 1st, 1986. Upon its release, the film was a critical and commercial failure and was criticized for its humor, performances, inconsistent tone, and the appearance of the title character through the effects and soundtrack were mostly praised. In the years since, it has been considered among the worst films of all time, although it has later become popular among audiences and gained a cult following through home video releases. It was nominated for 7 Razzie Awards, winning 4, and made about $15 million domestically compared to its $37 million budget, making the film a box office bomb. Wow. So, but I loved it. Like, I watched it. Like, I used to watch it every time it came on when it was on HBO. My parents would have HBO and Cinemax, and I'd be searching for a movie to watch on the middle of the Friday night, and there was Howard the Duck. And I'd watch Howard the Duck, and it was, I believe, PG-13 rated movie. So, like, you know, it had some adult themes to it, definitely. You know, I made the mistake of having my 12-year-old watch it with me, and didn't realize it till some of the scenes came up, exactly what the scenes were in the movie. But needless to say, she enjoyed it. She enjoyed what she was allowed to watch. And I enjoyed it too. And it was really one, to me, it was one of the first successful Marvel comic book movies that I ever saw. You know, short of George Reeves, or Marvel at least, sorry. DC had Superman with the Christopher Reeves Superman movie and the George Reeves Superman movies. But you know, we had never seen anything like Howard the Duck before. And so, like I said, I don't know why they voted it one of the worst films of all time. But it would be one of two movies that's on that list. That's two of my favorites in the Rocky Horror Picture Show and Howard the Duck. So, go figure.
I'm not going to sit here and tell you that, like, Howard the Duck is the most compelling film I've ever fucking seen in my life. But it's definitely not one of the worst. It's not something I'm going to look at and say that, you know, it's thought-provoking. But it's a fun little movie. It's not one of the worst films ever.
Yes, exactly.
But I vividly remember a lot of the scenes, though. Like, I saw it for the first time, like, when I was, like, 6 or 7. I was pretty young. But even now, I still remember a lot of the scenes in that movie just because it's so fucking dorky that it's that memorable for me, at least.
And that's kind of the appeal of a lot of movies like that. Like, there's mm-hmm. there are some movies like that go overboard. Like, I would never recommend watching the Rocky sequel, Shock Treatment. I've only seen it once in my life, and yeah, it was a very unique movie, I can say the least. It's another musical written by Richard O'Brien, but not nearly as good as
the old Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Yeah, the original Rocky Horror Picture Show. So, but all right, and then finally, let's wrap this up. Well, we both gave some thoughts on Howard there. Last thing, coming to HBO Max, you know, because they're all trying to push people to get that. My daughter's already asking me, she wants a HBO Max subscription for Christmas. HBO Max is going to have the Catwoman show featuring Zoe Kravitz based on her version of Catwoman from the Robert Pattinson Batman movie. I think this could be interesting. I think she could bring a lot to the role. For those of you who don't remember Zoe Kravitz, she's actually one of the first to cross over from the DC to the Marvel universe, or from the Marvel to the DC universe, or vice versa. Or she's among the first to do it. She did it for... she was in X-Men First Class. She's the one with the... Yeah, she's the one with the wings. Can't remember the name of the character.
She was in a lot of those movies at the time. I remember she was in Divergent, yes. Along with that, wasn't she?
Yes, I believe so. And for those of you who are sitting there saying, that last name sounds familiar. Yes, her father is Lenny Kravitz and her mother is Lisa Bonet.
The Lenny fucking Kravitz.
Yep. And Miss Lisa Bonet, Denise off the Cosby Show. From years ago. That's her mother, and Lenny Kravitz is her daddy. So.
Like, Lenny Kravitz is definitely like that Jason Momoa level of, like, goddamn, I wish I were you sort of thing, you know?
Yeah, big time. 100%. So, all right, guys. On that note, it's been about an hour, so it's time for us to take our commercial break, our podcast promo break. My voice is getting a little bit wispy. So I need to give it a rest for a couple minutes. But we're going to come back. We're going to talk some Raw. We're going to talk some SmackDown Live. We'll talk a little NXT, a couple of subjects from AEW, and also the surprise that WWE gave everybody this week. So you're listening to the Cheap Pop Podcast right here on the 4Aces.
Hey, listener.
You're listening to the Cheap Pop Podcast right here on the 4Aces Presents Radio Network. Spreaker.com, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and wherever you may find your favorite podcasts.
Hey, listener. Dutch here from Voice from the Underground, the podcast. My co-host and I want to invite you to check out our little corner of the podcast verse. At Voice from the Underground, we talk about all the crazy happening around us and try to make a little bit of sense out of the nonsense with little to no results. If the idea of hearing three semi-intelligent, outspoken nerds talk about politics, social issues, current events, sports, movies, pretty much anything that we decide to talk about because, well, it's our show, appeals to you, grab your shovel and come on down to the underground and then consult a qualified psychotherapist. Find us wherever you get your podcasts, just not where you buy your weed.
Voice from the Underground.
So, what's up? Steve Fingerstyles here, the host of the podcast, spelled DA, of course. Tune in each and every week to hear what pisses me off, what angers me, what I make fun of, and of course, my crazy rants. I also have incompetent co-hosts, cool guests, and a silent producer that sucks. So what more do you need from a podcast? You can listen on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, TuneIn, SoundCloud, and the Pod Bros Network. Peace.
From the galactic depths of the comic book universe comes the Ghosts of the Stratosphere, ready to galvanize and energize your mind with the latest of comic book news and reviews. And why are you stopping me?
Yes, that's much better. Hi, this is Andy Larson for Ghosts of the Stratosphere. Join me every week along with my co-hosts Rob Stewart and Chad Smith, as well as a cavalcade of fantastic comic book guests, as we dish out heaping helpings of the greatest and latest of comic book news and reviews. New shows posted every Tuesday with bonus shows every first Friday of the month. You can find us on iTunes and Stitcher under Ghosts of the Stratosphere, as well as on our website www.gotstratosphere.com. Hope to see you soon, folks.
All right, guys. So we're back. We're back. I just blew Alpha's mind. So with the rant I'm about to go on. So I'm about to go on it with you guys. Now, the reason why I call it a rant is because it is. You have got to be out of your goddamn mind if you think that WWE has lost the ability to tell long-term stories. Now, yes, we all say hindsight is 2020, but this particular scenario is so much that phrase, it's not even funny.
Almost hurts.
Exactly. You have to go back to shortly before WrestleMania happened, when Drew was still worried about Brock Lesnar after winning the Royal Rumble, and Randy was focused on Edge. Now, not only did we get 3 months of classic and amazing Orton and Edge promos and three amazing matches out of that, okay, then he moves on to Christian, then he moves on to the Big Show, and he has a little mini feuds with them, all building up this legend killer persona just to challenge Drew McIntyre and give him a true heel. Really, if you look at who Drew McIntyre has faced for the WWE title, he has not faced a true heel yet. Dolph Ziggler is about as close as he's come. But I mean like a true monster heel, like a Brock Lesnar type. And without bringing Brock back to get his rematch, they've developed Randy Orton right before your eyes into that monster heel character. And you think about little things like the fact that they've managed to keep Randy Orton, despite both of them being in the massive spotlight, they've managed to keep Randy Orton and Drew McIntyre away from each other since the Royal Rumble. Only to long build to this moment. 2 weeks from this Sunday or Sunday after next, Drew McIntyre versus the legend killer Randy Orton. You know, you get some icing on the cake with the punt to the head of Ric Flair and drawing Randy that extra heat. But all of this, you look back on it, all of this has been, all the matches that Drew McIntyre went through, all of this has been the build to this match at SummerSlam. And you gonna tell me that WWE doesn't know how to do long-term storytelling?
Mm-hmm.
You're going to tell me that Randy Orton isn't one of the best heels in the game right now? Fuck MJF. Love his gimmick and all, but fuck him. Sorry, not even on Randy's level. Not even close to on Randy's level. I love the whole Trump thing you have going there. Make AEW great again and shit. But the bottom line is, Randy Orton is the best thing going as far as a heel character right now, as far as the wrestling that I see on TV every day, or four to five times a week.
No, you're not wrong. Now that Ciampa has cooled down as a heat, and he isn't the most hateable thing in the world, I can say confidently Randy is the biggest, nastiest, best heel right now.
Yeah.
Everyone is saying, and I'm not afraid to fucking push the hype. No, Randy is on one of the best tangents of his whole fucking career. Sure. And he has proven it every step of the way. They've built it nice and slowly. They've brought back Christian just to get demolished. They brought that Big Show just to get demolished.
They're bringing back HBK next week on Raw.
Exactly. They're pulling out all the fucking stops.
So, yeah, like I said, it's something that I'm happy to see happen. I am truly happy to see happen. Because Randy Orton deserves it. Drew McIntyre deserves a legit, you know, threat to his title.
Challenge.
Because yeah. I never saw fucking Big Show or fucking Dolph Ziggler or anybody like that winning the title.
Exactly. Like, there are people that can challenge him, and of course we're not saying he isn't defending it, but it's different when they're put in a setting where, as a fan, we can actively look at the match and say, oh yeah, they could lose the belt to this fucking guy.
Yeah.
Like, confidently. Yes. Not because we don't believe they're at that level, but it's different when it's built up like this, right?
No, big time. And it's different, like I said, hindsight is 20/20. When you look back over all the little details, over all the little things you've seen on Raws, on SmackDowns, or something, that all led you to this, it's amazing storytelling. It truly is. How anybody could sit here and say that it's not baffles me. Now, don't get me wrong. Oh, okay, here's another one. Here's another one for you. All of the shit that we've seen over the past 2 to 3 weeks with Rey Mysterio and Seth Rollins has all been leading to the debut of Dominic Mysterio as a competitor for the WWE. Another great story told. Something's telling you, like the way you look at it, it makes sense. You have all this horrendous stuff. If you look over the weeks, week to week, Dominic began to get more and more involved in what was going on, whether it be verbally or physically. Dominic became more and more involved. And it was just 2 or 3 month build to Dominic's first match. Now, do I think Dominic's going to win?
No.
I can see it happening. I can see it happening, but it's going to be in a way where, like, Rey Mysterio has to come out and help him. He uses every weapon possible, including the sledgehammer, and Aleister Black comes out and knocks out Buddy Murphy. Like, that's about the only way I see it happening. Like, I don't see him getting just a clean win over Seth Rollins. Unless
yeah,
you never
it
know.
It is not going to be that simple.
Yeah, no, I don't think it will be. So, But yeah, that's another great story that's been told. I could have done without the horror. I could have done without the what was it? The horror whatever match at Extreme Rules.
The fucking eye gouge mania.
Yeah, I could have done without that 100%. But other than that, it's been great storytelling.
Yeah, yeah. I feel like I could have done without the whole I'm going to gouge out your fucking eye, Ray, on the corner of the steel steps. Not because I feel like it was too brutal or it was out of place. I don't know. I just feel like it could have been replaced with something fucking maybe more standard, just not as contrived.
Yep.
Like, couldn't you just fucking throw him in a cage like in the old days, damn it?
And here we go with the biggest story out of WWE this week. And I mean, and this is a game changer. SmackDown has officially gone to TV-14. They are no longer PG. I believe Raw is doing the same, at least during the last hour of Raw, because we've recently had this whole Raw Underground thing with Shane McMahon. This
MMA style. What are your feelings about that? What are your feelings about Raw Underground?
I like it. I still think it could have been done a little bit better. I like the concept. But I think if you're going to do that, it needs to legit be shoot fighting.
Yep.
Like, it needs to legit be shoot fighting. This can't be WWE staged, you know, MMA fighting. No, this should be legit shoot fighting. And so,
the closest... Oops, sorry, go ahead.
And you got to be picky and choosy about who you include in all of that, and who you include in all that, because they, like, to me, they made a mistake having the Hurt Business go in there and destroy everybody, and then the next week you have Apollo Crews get over on the Hurt Business, you know, with ease. Like, you can't sell them as these mega heels and then have your U.S. champ just get over on them like that. And I know I'm nitpicking, but, like, little things like that make, if you're going to put them over as that dangerous of a thing, then, dude, they should just be handling business. And so Raw Underground. But, like, for instance, I don't know if you watched this week's Raw Underground, but Shayna Baszler shows up. Okay, right. Like, here you have a real live, like, cage fighter. Like, let her whip somebody's ass. Like, legit. Like, you know, throw her a, and so they, you had this whole spot where like these three girls tried to take her down, and Shayna Baszler fought them all off and tapped the last girl out, and yeah, it could have been way more impressive. I'm happy with it. I hope they keep it going. I hope they take it back to some Attitude Era type shit. But like, or like last week, did you, okay, so you saw last week's, right? The very yeah, first yeah. Raw Underground. Okay, so they bring out that big yeah. dude.
They bring out Bobby Sunday.
Yeah. So they bring out yeah. Big Dude, right? So where the fuck's Big Dude when Bobby Lashley and everybody come rolling through and start destroying everybody? Like see,
no one went over anyone there.
You know, I'm just like, dude, like, and don't get me started on this wannabe Nexus angle, dude. Like, I'm not mad at it. Like, I think it injects some definite fun into it. But for me, it's been going on for 3 weeks and it's already gone on too long, by at least a week. Like, just reveal yourselves and become whatever faction you're going to become. Because all this cloak and dagger BS, I'm over it already.
Yeah, you're right. All the contrived. I don't know. A lot of it just feels like why go through all that shit when you could do it simpler and have it be presented better.
Yep.
Pertaining to Raw Underground, like the closest thing that I could ever see that coming to, and it being still like compelling and entertaining, is akin to like Josh Barnett's Bloodsport, where it was like this worked shoot. Yeah. Sort of thing. Well, like, yeah, they beat the living dog shit out of each other.
But they aren't really trying to hurt each other.
Exactly. Like, it was supposed to be, like, shoot-style type of shit. But, of course, it was still sanctioned. It was still work. That, taken into the Raw Underground setting, would be probably the best and safest way to go about it. It's not like they don't have the people that can do that. Yeah. They have Dijakovic, who might be that big motherfucker in that big fucking Nexus Angle group. Yeah. They have Dijakovic. They have fucking Bobby Lashley.
Yep.
They have Shayna on the women's side. They have any number of people that they could stuff in the Raw Underground for this whole thing to really work, right? When it just feels like they've thrown some people in there like, hey, yeah, these guys are sort of here too.
Yeah, like we got these, you know, guys. What I mean? You just look like a badass. Like, it's like, eh. Like, okay, like the dude that they brought out, the dude that did the spinning kick and knocked the dude out this week, it was like, all right, good for you.
Oh, no, yeah, that guy's an actual fighter. Yeah, but I want to see something more, you know?
Exactly. I want to see him fight. Like, give me a shoot fight. Like, you know what I'm saying? He doesn't need to knock somebody out, but shit, like, you know what I'm saying? He can go ahead and hit somebody. Oh, which, by the way, let me comment on this. Watching, and I stopped and rewound this just to watch it again. Watching Bayley versus Asuka this week, which, by the way, the fact that Asuka ended up with both the title shots at SummerSlam is kind of a weak thing to me. Like, I would have rather seen Baszler versus Bayley than Asuka versus Bayley and Asuka versus Shayna Baszler or Sasha Banks. But it is what it is. But what I'll say, there was a transition towards the end, actually at the very end of Bayley versus Asuka on Raw, where Asuka does this transition where Bayley comes running at her. It's like the final sequence. Bayley comes running at her. Asuka grabs her, flips her over into an armbar, slides her, like, in a matter of seconds, flips her over to the armbar, slides her over, and locks her in the Asuka lock. And it was such a smooth, it was literally the smoothest move I've seen between two women in any wrestling match that I have visibly watched this year. I can't say it's the best one in all of them because I haven't seen all of them. But I can say it's the best one in any one of the ones I've seen. And it was just such a boom, boom, boom transition. You know, very easily mistakes could have been made there, but they weren't. And it just showed, like, exactly how good they are. Yeah, exactly. Now, lastly, before we move off of Raw and SmackDown, have you guys the chance to see the end of SmackDown this week? No, but you heard about it, right?
Yeah, I have absolutely heard it, seen it, watched the clip.
All right, we've had Alexa Bliss. who I guess now is admitting that she had feelings for Braun Strowman or something, and she's mad because Braun said he don't give a fuck about her, her mama, her cousins. He don't give a shit about none of them. Came back with a new bald look. Evidently, Braun done gone crazy since he was in the swamp match at the horror show.
Changed his fucking head, Britney style.
Yeah, he pancake dropped Alexa Bliss. Yeah. I don't get it, but it should lead to a good match between the Fiend and, because you would always assume, like, evidently the other members of the Wyatt family obviously had to have, like, powers and shit. Like, Bray couldn't have been the only motherfucker that had them.
Yeah, of course. The idea is, you know, Bray wasn't the only one that was able to do some crazy fucking shit. They were all backwater magicians and shit, right?
Pretty much. And so that's where we're at right now. And I liked the little segment at the end of SmackDown. It was all right. Like I said, I guess the way that they're showing the transition between PG to TV-14 is by the fact that now we have more situations where men are putting their hands on women. But not in a, like, striking type manner, but, you know, wrestling holds, etc.
And someone says bitch every episode. That's how we get the grade, boys. Not by compelling storytelling.
Exactly. So, but we'll okay, I'd like to see where they're going to take it.
To be fair, hearing Keith Lee say the only thing missing from that paper is your punk ass name was one of the Raw's fucking lines.
Oh, yes. I have yet to see that. I have yet to watch my NXT yet. But you can go ahead and fill us in, brother.
Okay, it is worth it, probably damn near just for that right there. But I think, was it... Let me go make sure. NXT this week as a whole, though, was pretty good. The main event, especially, was fucking great. The main event being a triple threat between Kushida and Cameron Grimes. And, surprise, surprise, the final and third entrant in the match was the returning Velveteen Dream, which
really?
I'll talk a little bit more about. Yeah, I'll talk a little bit more of that by the end of the episode.
All right.
But, all right, yes, as I thought so, it opens with Karrion Kross defeating old boy Danny Burch, the governor, the big, bald English bastard. And again, I'm not going to let this shit go. Why the fuck did Danny Burch get in more offense than goddamn Ciampa? I've seen Kross work, and I've seen Ciampa work, and I know damn well the type of work that they can do and the type of matches they can have. So why the fuck was Ciampa and Kross ended in 5 seconds where Danny Burch ended up getting so much more offense than Ciampa came anywhere near? That shit better be specific, and I better see Ciampa get in some real shit, bro, because this shit sucks. Sorry about my little tangent. But aside from that, Danny Burch versus Karrion Kross was actually pretty good.
No problem, man. I go watching on my rants too.
Right? Cross actually sold pretty well for Burch, and Burch sold his fucking ass off. The match ends with Keith Lee coming back out and saying, you know, here's the contract for the match. The only thing missing is your punk-ass name in one of the Raw's fucking lines of the week.
Nice.
And nice. Cross, spoiler alert, Cross and Scarlett hand it back to him, right? And then Keith Lee picks up the fucking paper to look at it again. And surprise, surprise, he opens it up and gets fucking blasted in the mouth with flames. The paper fucking explodes. And so Keith Lee falls back and has to be carried out of the ring for the next, like, fucking 20 minutes.
Okay.
While the next match comes along. Yeah, while the next match comes along. Adam Cole comes out and shit-talks Pat McAfee, as he would. And then we ended up seeing Santos Escobar, previously known as Hijo del Fantasma, fight Tyler Breeze after Santos Escobar and his boys literally, and I shit you not, just fucking kidnapped Fandango. They just whack him in the side of the head and throw him in the back of a car and just drive away. And that's the end of it. So that's why these dudes are fighting. It was a pretty good match. I always enjoy seeing the man who was under the mask of Hijo del Fantasma work.
He's a great heel.
Next came up. Exactly. Yeah, because he was a pretty good heel. Next up, we would see Mia Yim versus Indy Hartwell. If I remember correctly, it was just the play-by match for once. Nothing really too big happened. I believe Mia Yim came out on top, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
And then came Bronson Reed versus Damian Priest, which was as good as how you think that match would be between the two men. It's more or less just gearing up these men again for the ladder match coming up and take over.
For the North American Championship.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah. Oh.
And then next came up Aaliyah and Mercedes Martinez, the freshly picked from AEW, managed to defeat Caden Carter and Casey Catanzaro. I actually personally quite enjoy the team of Caden Carter and Casey Catanzaro. I may be just a little bit biased. It opened with another snooty promo from the Robert Stone brand. And then came along.
Yeah, kind of over Robert Stone, really. Sorry for being a little late on that. Yeah, I'm kind of over Robert Stone. Like, dude just needs to
Yeah, you're not really wrong there. Yeah, it's okay at best, and it kind of sucks that Mercedes Martinez, an incredibly good competitor, is almost stuck with that.
Yeah. You know? Aren't they feuding with with Rhea Ripley right now?
Yeah, they're going back and forth with Rhea Ripley and with generally any face that comes around. It's generally their whole thing.
Yeah.
But Cameron Grimes and Kushida and the returning Dream match was hands down the match of the night. The two guys came out first, and then we did what we always do when Dream returns. Yeah. And so everything stops. There's no sound. A new Titantron plays, and you know, it's always one that we've never seen before, right? And then some way, shape, or form, some fucking how, it switches to the Dreams logo, and he comes out on the fucking couch. classic Dream shit, and it was great. He came out and did the triple threat match, went through all of the usual Dream moves, dive to the outside, the Dream Valley driver. He's grown his hair out, so he looks like a fucking mop. But that, along with the fact that he has dyed his facial hair, he has bleached it. And so at first, he kind of looks like one of those birds from Jungle Book, but it's going to grow on me, I can tell. Match finishes with Cameron Grimes, who I've said it a million times before, I have a fucking intense love for. I love seeing the dude work. I've loved him since he was Trevor Lee. But the match finishes with Damian Priest holding Kushida in almost like an end of day sort of elevated flatline position, holding him like in a weird little angle like that. And so Cameron Grimes from the corner just darts up, jumps over, and nails Kushida with the jumping stomp that he does.
Damn.
Just fucking plants Kushida perfectly, and you could see Kushida's soul leave his fucking body.
Yeah,
got all the whiplash, all the shit. Cameron Grimes pins him for the 1-2-3, letting my boy, fucking Cowboy, go ahead and go for the ladder match. And I'm hyped for that. Honestly, I'm really digging that.
Okay, man, I'm gonna ask you this question since we're on the subject.
Let's go.
AEW has been persistently beating NXT in the ratings. I put up air quotes because I really am not a big, like, ratings matter type guy.
Yeah.
But do you think this has more to do with the, what I call the shiny penny process? NXT is something that a lot of people have already been watching for years. They know that they can watch it.
Established in the very beginning in 2012,
yeah.
Actually.
Well, this version of NXT. NXT has been around since, like, I want to say 2009. Like,
that's true, the game show version.
Right.
Even if you want to splice it like that, our version of NXT came out in 2013 at absolute latest.
Right. So you're looking at NXT, I think that, you know, the shininess is worn off of NXT. Everybody knows they're going to get quality matches from a great roster, you know, that's eventually going to be on the main roster. So do you think that the gap of about, on average, about 180,000 fans has more to do with the shiny penny philosophy than it has to do with AEW actually being a better product? Because I really don't see it as a better product.
I'm very big on ratings not even being something that can really even dictate the quality of a product.
Yeah,
I feel like ratings aren't even something that you can really look at. That's why I loved the phenomenal rating scale this week with Joseph Park and all that, because it's to make fun of, like, you know, everybody somehow quantifying, numbering, and grading wrestling like that.
Yeah.
But as a whole, you know, that probably is possible. I can definitely 100% see it. Like, you know, AEW's only over a year old by now.
Yeah.
Of course they're gonna have a lot of eyes on it, and a lot of people trying to judge it and taste it and understand it first.
Yep.
So of course there's going to be a lot more people going there just to be there to even check it out, to even understand it to begin with. So of course, you know, I can definitely see that contributing to a higher ratings. But even then, far and wide, it's like, as far as I can tell right now, if you're looking for the best wrestling around, NXT is where you're going to want to look regardless of how you feel, you know?
Mm-hmm. 100%.
Yeah.
So,
but no, yeah, I agree. I believe that 100% could contribute, and I believe, and it still absolutely could and would right now.
So there are three things that have come out of AEW in the past couple of weeks that were major. A, the return of Sammy G, and then beginning a feud with Matt Hardy, or Matthew Hardy.
Oh, okay. Keep a tab on old boy Sammy G, because I have a question about that later.
Okay. We had the big win by Orange Cassidy over Chris Jericho. That was a huge one.
Right.
And then last but not least, you had the arrival of the one and only Eric Rowan. I forget which name he's going by now. Eric Redbeard.
It's Joseph something, because he's using his real name.
Is he? Okay.
Yeah.
But he is now a member of the AEW roster. So those are really the big three stories that are coming out of AEW over the past couple of weeks. Any thoughts on that? That, and they finished the TNT title finally, so it's got its gold plating now.
Right, yeah, it doesn't have the silver plating, which, if I'm being honest, it didn't even look like a bad title to begin with. I didn't know what all the fuss was about. It was an okay title, but now it looks pretty damn good. So I do like the gold plating a lot. Of course, I'm always I'm always for older wrestlers putting over the newer ones, especially like Jericho, who is probably on the final 5 years of his career now, right?
Easy.
And if you remember, I called Eric Rowan joining AEW like fucking three, four months ago. If you remember, like the very second
that they released
old boy Luke Harper. And Eric Rowan was on Chopping Block 2. I came on here and I was like, oh yeah, he's gonna go with him, or he's gonna go to Japan, because that's what Rowan did before this point. So hey, I'm all for it, because I don't know if I'm one of the only few people, but I actually quite enjoy Rowan. I think he's a good worker. I think he works better with old boy Brody Lee, because they've worked together like four or five fucking years now together. But go ahead.
I'm hoping that they make him a member of the Dark Order, just because the Dark Order needs something, some kind of infusion in it. Dark Order isn't really as over as I think they should be. I think it was a failed gimmick that never really took direction, kind of like this Retribution gimmick. And so I think that having Luke now have a brother who can actually cut a promo, I think will work wonders for that group. I can completely see where you're coming from. Like Eric Rowan, but what's been surprising to me is not as many people joined AEW as they thought. Like everybody expected a lot of the major names to join AEW, and Gallows and Anderson went to Impact, followed with Heath Slater. Fucking Rusev hasn't really showed up anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. For the most part, all the people that we really expected to go to AEW haven't really gone there, huh?
Yeah, EC3 ended up going to Impact. So, like, you know, like, that's the part that surprises me, is that there just hasn't been as many people that went to AEW as I thought there was going to be. So, bravo to Impact for splitting up the game and not allowing AEW to snap up all the big name, you know, WWE releases. And I honestly think Rusev's going to end up coming back, because I know the Bulgarian group was making quite a bit before, and I think them releasing him had more to do with them wanting to restructure that contract than it had to do with them wanting to get rid of him to get all together.
Think so?
Yeah.
From what I've heard, he said that he was done with wrestling.
Really?
And then he said that he was going to go stream on Twitch, and he was going to be a full-time streamer. And then I believe Twitch actually fucking banned him. I forget why, but they banned him. So now he's off of doing that, and he's free agenting again right now. So I definitely wouldn't put it past him to go back there. But with how he seemed to feel, would I bet on it? I don't think so.
Yeah, true. I could see him just kind of sitting out, because, like I said, he was at a point where he was making $2-3 million a year during his run, during his peak of his run. So, like, he very well could have just stashed a lot of money and just be down to just chill, never go back to wrestling. There's been guys that have done it before. You know, their run came to an end, and they were just done. Maybe come back for a special appearance here and there for WWE, but that'll be about it. So what was it that you were going to say about, put a plug in about Sammy G?
Okay, so I want to hear what you have to say about this. As you know, we are either coming out of or are still in a pretty banged up time in the wrestling world, I like to consider. I'm not going to say it's one of the worst times. We're nowhere near fucking like 90s steroid trials of wrestling being in a bad place, right?
Yeah.
But that being said, among the last three, four months, I would say, I think I can say confidently we've had a pretty rough patch in the world of wrestling, right? Most of it coming from the fact that, regardless of the allegations, a lot of people and a lot of shit has been brought to light, right?
Right.
Now, that all being said, there is a lot of electricity, a lot of buzz on Sammy G being back, and now Velveteen Dream being back, too.
Yeah.
Do you think it was smart to bring them back?
Well, what?
Do you think it was even a good idea to do that?
You got to fill me in a little bit. I know what Sammy G did. You got to fill me in on what was up with Velveteen Dream. Why did he get? Why was he written off TV for a little bit?
Okay. Well, Sammy G, you heard what he said about Sasha Banks, and he had to go do training and all that.
Yeah.
And so there's all of that. I believe in the very beginning, about 3 months ago, Dream was accused of sending pictures to a minor. And they looked into that. Multiple places looked into it, and it came out as a huge ass malicious attack on him, right?
Okay.
And so.
Okay. So now,
because of that, and there was another one over the past 2 months of almost the exact same light that was looked into the same way, and if I'm not mistaken, came out the same exact way of that was very clearly just a malicious attack on him. And so now that Dream is back, I hear a lot of people saying that they just never, ever should have outright done that at this point. given the situation and the speed that everything is still in.
Okay.
I'm interested, because I'm seeing a lot of different shit all over the place.
I look at it like this. I'm all about the innocent until proven guilty. Now, I do understand the theory. I don't necessarily agree, but I do understand the theory that where there's a lot of smoke, there's most likely fire. And so when you start seeing accusations, I call it the Cosby theory. And this is and people have to bear with me here. When Bill Cosby was first accused by the first woman, it was like, all right, Bill might have done this, but I just don't think Bill did this. Like, Bill's innocent. Now, with Bill, it turned out to be the first analogy along with the second result. And the first analogy is this. Where there's smoke, there's fire. Once you got to the 10th, 11th, 12th, 15th, 17th woman that was making kind of similar, if not the same, accusations, it's like, well, Bill's kind of harder at this point to believe in you when you say you're innocent of all this. You know, like, and then the deposition tape came out with him basically admitting the shit, and it was like, Bill, all right, now, you're not innocent anymore. So, at this point, you're guilty. So now I have to start looking at you as somebody who is guilty. Velveteen Dream is still in the early stages of if there's smoke, there's fire type situation. There's only been two accusations. Both have been investigated. Both have been found false. Because of that, I'm more inclined to believe that there's no harm done in bringing Dream back. He was accused. It was investigated. He was found not guilty. Either come with better evidence or sorry about your luck. It sucks, but it is what it is. You feel?
Mm-hmm.
Sammy G, I'm going to say the same thing. I don't think it was too early to bring him back. I think they waited 30 days for the heat of the story to die down. Now, AEW had to be fully aware that by retaining Sammy G, that they were going to lose a certain subset of their fans anyway. I believe that there are people who are out there who are like myself, who are completely against rape, who completely don't believe that rape is something that should ever happen, who believe that anybody that commits it needs to be put in jail, and whatever happens to them, they pretty much earned. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
There's a subset that believes like me. And then there's this subset that believes if the word rape is even used out of female's mouth, that dude automatically needs to have his entire life destroyed. That subset is
very fucking real.
Yeah, that's the subset that believes that Sammy G should have been basically eliminated from life, head put under the guillotine and chopped off because he said he wanted to rape her. I don't believe that that's the level it needed to go to. Take some sensitivity training. Learn to not say shit like that. Not even in private. You know, and go learn. Take some time off. Go learn. Basically, go sit in the corner and think about what you did. To put it in old 80s mama terms. Okay? Yeah. He sat in the corner. He learned what he did. Now it's time to give him the opportunity to come back and show that he learned from what happened. Now, should he ever stumble down that road again and make a similar or the same mistake, then cancel his ass. Then you're done. But I believe that everybody, if it's earned, deserves a check and chance. What I mean by if it's earned is if they show contrition, which he did, they apologize for what they did, which he did, and they serve their time, whatever that may be, whether that be time in jail. You know, I got a friend of mine right now that's like, yeah, dude, you know, my ex is trying to mess with me about being a felon, da da da. And I'm like, dude, you did your time. That should be forgiven. You did your time. You went and served your thing.
Mm-hmm.
Sammy did his time. Sammy served his fate. Same thing with Velveteen Dream. Velveteen Dream, he served his fate. without even necessarily being guilty of the crime, he served his fate.
Mm-hmm.
Sammy served his fate.
Yeah.
Now time to let the young man come back and prove that he has changed, that things are different, and that he's not going to be doing anything like that anymore. And Dream, bro, can't have too many more of these cases before where there's smoke, there's fire. But go ahead. Sorry. Just wanted to get that last part.
No, you're right. You're right about that, 100%. I feel like it is one of the biggest travesties as a wrestling community about the fact that we saw the rise of Enzo Amore, who, yeah, regardless of what you can say about his in-ring ability, was a great fucking character,
yep,
and was entertaining as a character and knew how to work the mic and knew how to work a crowd.
Yep.
And Cass may not have been promising in a few ways, but I, honest to God, feel like Enzo had the chops to be something in the wrestling industry.
Yeah. He may not have been winning any heavyweight championships, but he was going to be an icon.
Exactly, exactly. And I feel like it is a fucked up thing as a community and as wrestling fans that we have stopped talking about the fact that he lost his whole entire career over allegations that were dropped because there was not enough evidence for the fact. And that he lost his whole fucking career off of that in that exact moment. And I don't mean that, and I mean that with no hyperbole, as, yeah, in they looked at his allegations and were instantly like, nah, you gotta get the fuck out of here. And that's how it went down.
And there are certain things that you can do. And someone would think that definitely, like, saying you want to rape a girl. I think, I'll be honest with you, I think here's where the Sammy G situation could have paralleled the Enzo Amore situation. If the Sammy G situation was from recently, you know what I'm saying? Like if this was a podcast he had taped, like, 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
I think we would have saw Sammy canceled altogether.
Oh yeah,
and then at least for a significant amount of time.
Exactly, and I would have agreed for it. But the difference is, Sammy G said this shit when he was 12.
Yeah.
imagine losing your job over a joke that you made with you before you even had hair on your nuts, bro. Imagine.
Now, I agree, but the little bit of exaggeration I think takes the context out of it. Sammy was in his early 20s when he made that comment. He was old enough to know better. Now, have we all made stupid mistakes? Yeah. Like, I want to say that Sammy is like...
I heard he was like way younger than that, dude.
Well, remember, Sammy Guevara is like 26. Like, he's between 24 and 26. And this only happened 4 years ago.
I swear I had heard he said it in like 2012. Oh, shit on me for being misinformed, man. That's
yeah,
on
no,
me.
Yeah, I want to say it was... Hold on.
Yeah, I was going to say, I thought he was, like, way younger than that, too.
Let's see. It's a 2016 podcast, yeah. And Sammy appeared...
It was 2016? Oh, Jesus.
2016 podcast after working as an extra for a WWE. So, it was 4 years ago. And like I said, I believe, like, the dude's, like, 26 years old. And so, like...
He was 22 at the time. 22 at the time.
Yeah, he was
okay,
22
right.
at the time. So, I'm not saying he was a grown-ass man, but he was old enough to know better, you know, and to know
old
what the impact
of
his... Right. And so that's where I say he deserved a punishment. Those that say he didn't deserve to be punished at all because he was young. If he was 15, maybe. I can relate.
Yeah.
But at 22, he knew enough to know not to say some shit like that. But anyway,
at
the end of the day...
He should have went through the training, though? Yeah.
Yes.
But do I think he was... He should have been blackballed from the fucking industry?
Nah, not even close. That wasn't even close. If that's the case, then Hulk Hogan should be banned from the industry after some of the shit he's been caught saying.
Yeah, exactly.
Hell, like, Dog the Bounty Hunter got another show after the shit he said he was caught saying. So, we will always forgive you as long as you show contrition and get some sensitivity training. People will be forgiven with certain things, not with everything, though.
Exactly.
All right, so last subject of the night before we wrap this up. WWE Network has added something special. Not only have they added a free version of the WWE Network for those of you who don't want to pay the $9.99 a month to get all the extra pay-per-views and everything, which is basically what you're paying the $9.99 a month for now, is to get the pay-per-views, because pretty much everything else is available on the free version. All the on-demand content is available on the free version, and Raw Talk every, at the end of every Monday night, etc. So, it's and they got a new show coming up called Timeline. But why don't you tell them about what you really get with that free membership that's special?
What really matters now, right? Yep. As of today, August 15th, we have ourselves the Libraries of Progress, ICW, Evolve, and I believe two or three other promotions. But for me, at least, that's mainly the crop that matters. As you know, I'm a big Evolve fan. Tapings are what, not even a full 2 hours away from our recording location.
Heck yeah, man! Oh, real quick, love that drop, because I want people to go watch and learn about a young man from Sacramento, a young man who trained at SPW. Young man by the name of Timothy Thatcher. He's possibly one of the best ground and pound wrestlers in the game today, wrestling for NXT, and just recently did some research into him and found out that he is from Sacramento and that he trained at SPW, and he is a multiple time APW heavyweight champion and a APW internet champion as well.
He is actually the longest reigning Evolve champion of all time as well.
Exactly. So now you have a chance to go watch a lot of this man's work in Evolve. You can actually go to the APW website and find several matches with him involved in it. I believe it's APW.com. But yeah, I did not know that man, just like Miss Shotzi Blackheart. I've talked about her before because they list her from Oakland, but y'all got to realize, like, she's Hood Slam Oakland. Like, for those of you who know local indie wrestling, like in the Bay Area, Hood Slam is huge and has been for like almost 20 years now. And she was a part of Hood Slam. Miss High as Can Be or something like that was her name or something. And yeah, it's just good to see these local people getting over in NXT and in WWE.
Two very, very good fucking wrestlers among them, I believe.
Yep. You got Bayley and that's running the game right now with Sasha Banks, mm-hmm. You know, and then you got Timothy, and yeah, we got a lot of people repping Kelly.
You look at Timothy Thatcher, you look at that man's eyes. Do you see that? You see that 1,000-yard stare?
Oh,
you see that hatred for being alive? That's what happens when you're raised in Sacramento, bro.
I always thought that was Lodi. No. you know, yeah, I live in the Bay Area. Gotta take exactly. Oh man, yeah, nah. I just wish I'd had a chance to see him when he was still out here and wrestling. Like, I've heard of him multiple times, but I never really got a chance to see him on the indie circuit. And knowing that he was so close, and I never really got a chance to check him out, kind of disappoints me. But
yeah, well, now you can go look at his old work, right?
Yep. Now I can. So, all right, man, you said no wrestler of the week. Is there anything else wrestling-wise you want to cover?
I believe that is it. That is it on my end.
All right, my friend. So that's going to do it for us here this week. I believe stay tuned for Now versus Then a little bit later on tonight. Backtrack and check out, Inspiration Radio and Brick House. Tomorrow night we have... Dirty Talk 101. Tuesday nights, forget who we have now. Wednesday nights we have Kelly Kell with Kings and Queens of Porn and Lip Gloss and Mics. And then Thursdays belongs to Miss Toy with Lovely Radio. And Fridays belong to me. With this week, I'm going to be covering musicals. So this week we're going to have music from the Broadway musical Hamilton. From the Broadway musical, or from the London musical, Les Mis, And from, what was it? There were four that I was going to do. Oh, Grease. And then last but not least would be the one and the only Dr. Horrible's sing-along vlog. Nice. Oh, was I going to do Phantom? Okay, well, then never mind. I guess I'm doing Phantom of the Opera as well. I'll throw in some extra tracks and throw some my favorite ones from Dr. Horrible in there, too. But that's going to be coming up this Friday. And then Saturday brings us to Mr. Deacon's Experience before we come back around to Sunday, which hopefully this next Sunday we should be going up as well. And West Coast Bias should be within the next couple of Sundays as well. So, all right, y'all. That's it. Any last words for your people?
All right, boy, you better make sure to get some Little Shop of Horrors in there for me.
Oh, yeah.
You know you better.
Oh, yeah. I'll throw some Little Shop of Horrors in there.
That's my boy. All right. My people, you know how it is. Please be safe. Be good. We'll be back one more time before SummerSlam to get some predictions in, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We will. Till then, y'all. We out. Peace.
Peace.